you know, my grandparents, I would go to Arkansas every summer and sit around the piano. My grandmother would play piano. I would play jazz guitar, and my grandpa would play saxophone. You know, and here I am, 6, 7, 8, 9 years old, and I'm learning, you know, jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those peepers? Because my grandma would be singing. And so I learned all these 1920s and 30s and 40s songs. And so when I first saw George Burns, which I believe must have been in Oh God, right? Because that was when he kind of broke through to another generation. I thought he was the coolest thing, even cooler than John Denver. And I loved John Denver. And so I wrote him a letter. And back then you had to go to the library. My mom drove me to the library, and you went in the back of the library, and there was this big book, and you opened it up, and there was famous people's addresses you could write to them. And we found George Burns in the library. So I wrote him this letter, and my mom took some photographs of me, and we sent him the letter and the photographs. And I drew a map to our house in case he came to Houston. And I told him I would take him to dinner.
The Sara show, and Sara is doing a song, and she accidentally during the first verse starts singing the second verse, and all of a sudden in Sara's mind it's like, does not compute, oh, you know, damn, I got the lyrics wrong. And Linda shouts the lyrics to the second verse, and Linda goes, and you know, Sara doesn't know it's Linda because on stage you can't see. And she's like, yes, that's it. And so Sara starts the song again and does it the right way. And Linda was beaming with with pride.
You know, and just at Port David's when she was mouthing the words like on the second row or something to me. And yeah. I was just like, you know, I have to say, I've been at shows, you know, like I remember the first time that happened was at a John Denver show. Everybody was singing every song of, you know, it was just like one big awesome swimming pool full of people singing, and I loved it. And I think part of the reason why I always wanted to do sing-alongs was because I thought, well, that will get people to sing with me, and that'll be like what happened with John Denver or Hart or whoever.
Yeah.
I see. But I think it's even more exciting when I can't remember. And I saw this when I toured with Richie Havens. He was at a stage in his life where he would almost every song forget words in the song. But the audience was listening so intently. The minute he would drop out, he would keep playing the guitar, they would rise up in their, not like stand up, but their voices would rise up, and they would carry him through to when he would start remembering. And I was so floored by that kind of love.
Oh, that's
so when
beautiful.
Linda does that, or someone else knows my song better than I do, it's like, how do they, oh my gosh, what an honor. I'm so flattered. That means so much to me. But tell Linda.
I will. She will. All right. You're signed from Elektra. Mm-hmm. You're able to do Shortstop. Wonderful album. You got to be on the Tonight Show, which I would love. I don't know if you have time to tell that story, if you want to tell that story, but your boyfriend at the time comes over to our house to watch you on the Tonight Show.
Is that where he was?
Yes.
God, and I don't even remember that.
Yes. And
Sandy?
Yes, Sandy. Oh. And he's going, oh, this is not going well. And
but wait, tell people. So I was on the Tonight Show, and you're watching me on the Tonight Show, right?
Yes.
And Sandy says to you,
yes, he goes, really, yeah, this is
I
not going well.
Tell that, but he knew
I
was mad.
And
it's my first time on the Tonight Show, so that's like, I go to the Tonight Show, I get to the Tonight Show, all the things that you would think are going to happen, it's magical. I got to see where Johnny Carson parked his white Corvette. It had a Johnny Carson sign. You go in, you go to the green room, they have your name on the door. I still have that sign somewhere. You go into makeup, they put your makeup on, you've gotten styled, you've brought the clothes that the stylist has put together for you. And in this case, it was always people that either owned small shops that I knew that I wanted to support and give them, you know, exposure, or it was friends of mine who were designers that would make me clothes to wear so they could say, my friend wore this on the Tonight Show, right? So anyway, I had to go in makeup, And the woman in makeup was like this strong Russian lady who says, oh, you're from Texas. I make you big, big hair. And I'm like, just because I'm from Texas doesn't mean I want big hair. She's like, no, no, no. We make you, ooh, and you have big lips. I make you bigger lips. So I'm sitting in the chair and she gets these orange juice cans and puts them on my head and then takes them out. And I have this huge beyond Farrah Fawcett hair. And then she takes this red lipstick, boo, 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 and I have these huge, massive lips. They look ridiculous. Anyway, that was the first sign that things were not going to go well. So I went in the bathroom and I'm wiping everything off and flattening my hair. And she kept going, why you fix? No, let me fix it. Oh, it's terrible. Anyway, then the talent coordinator came in and says to me, hey, you can't play that song tonight. The censor came in and she said that it's too, you need to change some lyrics. It's too naughty, which by today's standards is not naughty at all. It wasn't naughty really back then. No. It was snarky, if anything. Yeah. So I said, well, and my manager's in the green room with me and a person from Elektra is there and then the talent coordinator from The Tonight Show. And I said, no, I'm going to sing it the way it is. And he's like, I thought you might say that. So I took the liberty of rewriting the lyrics for you. And he hands me this piece of paper. And I'm like, no. And I could just see.
Do you remember the lyrics?
They're sweating like, no. Just do whatever they want. You're about to be on the Tonight Show.
And do you remember the rewritten lyrics?
Yes. So okay. His lyrics were, well, let me say, my lyrics were, she dives into his pants. That was it.
That was the problem. Yes.
To me, which was very surreal and funny, right? Yeah. You know, he wanted me to sing, she does a finger dance upon his pants, or she unzips his pants. Now, to me, both of those are far worse than she dives into his pants, because that's like a Charles Bukowski, you know.
It's just, exactly. Yes.
It's ridiculous. So I said no. And now everybody's like, oh, no. And he said, well, then you'll have to do another song. And he left the room. And now it's like 10 minutes till showtime. And the band that I'd rehearsed with was the Tonight Show band, which was actually, I believe, Denny Fonghiser had come in, who plays with Peter Frampton, the drummer for Peter Frampton and other amazing people. And Randy Jackson, as you know him from American Idol, he was one of the judges on American Idol. He was the bass player. And he came in, I think. And then my friend Brad McLemore was there as a guitarist. So I find Brad and I say, I can't do too fast. We're going to do Last Night Was a Big Rain. And he goes,
because they wouldn't let you do Simply.
They wouldn't let
me do Simply. If I remember correctly.
Which I think if they'd let me do Simply right there, my life would have been different.
Yes.
I think that's one of the things that was not my mistake.
Yeah.
That was the song they said, we'll do this one because it's upbeat.
Yeah. Like,
I'll tell you simply, I'm falling for you. I've never felt this way before. I don't need flowers and I don't mind tears. I just need you through the years.
And I do agree. I think that because Simply is an amazing song,
well,
right?
It feels like a song that's always been a classic.
Right. Yes, it is classic. Yes.
Not because I wrote it, but just it has that feeling.
Well, and by the way, Willie Nelson ended up covering it for you. So, you know,
as
so.
As did Greg Combo.
Yes, it did. Yes. So, anyway, so.
Brad runs out to the band, and nobody knows this song but Brad. And I'm about to go on live national television with my grandparents, you know, everybody, you, Sandy, all these people watching. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm about to play a song with a band that does not know this song except the other guitar player. And so I started and I guess he's over there yelling, go to C, you know, okay, go to D. Oh, here comes an F, which you can't hear him.
Right.
But I can see him over there. So I'm just hanging on and singing like nothing's a problem. And I get to the end of the song and I'm doing one of those big rave ups like Pete Townsend does. And I finish the song, but the band is like rocking now. They're like, bam. And I'm like, you know, what do I do? So I start playing the song again, because now I'm really mad. I'm not mad at the band. I'm just mad at the situation. So that's, I'm sure Sandy was just like, oh boy.
Yeah, because it is, and I'm sure it's on YouTube. I didn't check, but yeah, I mean, you're just, you're like, you keep like, okay, I'm over, you know, like it's, the song's over, people.
You can see my face, like, I'm looking like, okay, I'm just gonna, somebody will end this somehow. Mm-hmm.
You've had great moments, and there's so many stories, but
and you're so nice to have me on, because I'm not really giving the listeners much about Bruce, but
no, that's this is fine. Okay. This is Set Less Thing Sarah.
SLS.
Yes. Well, how high was meeting George Burns on your list of accomplishments? That, you know, there are people that have, okay, like, here's a Bruce story. Mm-hmm. A couple of years ago, Brian Wilson was touring, and he was in New Jersey, and for the encore, Bruce Springsteen came on stage and played two songs with Brian Wilson. Wow. He played guitar, and I've told multiple people, forget Chris getting married, forget me seeing grandkids. If I had been in that audience and saw Brian Wilson and Bruce Springsteen perform together, take me away. That's it. My life, you know, I've had a good life. I love you, Linda, but this is, you can take me away. Because could there be any further ultimate?
You're already in heaven right there.
Yeah, exactly. So you have loved George Burns from, right from the moment you can remember, right?
I had two grandparents who were the only other musicians in the family, true musicians who toured and played. My grandmother played a big, amazing piano. I keep saying amazing, but anyway, sorry. And my grandfather played saxophone and clarinet and toured with big swing bands. And my grandmother had her own radio show in New York City in the 20s with her sister called the Ozark Smile Sisters. And I just recently inherited a trunk full of all the paraphernalia from their radio show.
Oh, how cool.
It's so amazing. There's fan mail in there to them. There's the official letter that invited them to have their own radio program on the letterhead. And there's photos of them outside the radio station. It's just crazy cool. Anyway. So, my grandparents, I would go to Arkansas every summer and sit around the piano. My grandmother would play piano. I would play jazz guitar, and my grandpa would play saxophone. You know, and here I am, 6, 7, 8, 9 years old, and I'm learning, you know, jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those peepers? Because my grandma would be singing. And so I learned all these 1920s and 30s and 40s songs. And when I first saw George Burns, which I believe must have been in Oh God, right? Because that was when he kind of broke through to another generation. I thought he was the coolest thing, even cooler than John Denver, and I loved John Denver. And so I wrote him a letter, and back then you had to go to the library. My mom drove me to the library, and you went in the back of the library, and there was this big book, and you opened it up, and there was famous people's addresses you could write to them. And we found George Burns in the library. So I wrote him this letter, and my mom took some photographs of me, and we sent him the letter and the photographs, and I drew a map to our house in case he came to Houston, and I told him I would take him to dinner. So he wrote me back. He wrote me back twice. Yeah, so I wrote him twice. He wrote me twice. And that was enough for me. You know, I was a kid. That was amazing. And then in my 20s, when I went on the Pat Sajak show, he had
yes.
a nighttime show for a bit. And I think most people know this, but before you go on any show, the Tonight Show, Dave Letterman, anything like that, they ask you questions ahead of time to feed to the host so they know what to
yeah.
talk about. So I guess either I or Elektra had told Pat Sajak that, or his people, that I loved George Burns and that I'd been pen pals with him. So I'm on Pat Sajak's show, and he gives me some stationery from George Burns and a signed book from George Burns and a cigar from George Burns with George Burns' label on the cigar. And then the next day, George Burns' manager, who had watched that Pat Sajak episode, called Elektra all the way in New York and said, "Hey, I saw that kid on TV talking about George, and I think she should come over here and meet George." And so sure enough, they sent a limo. I was still in LA. I went over to George's studio in the whatever, you know, whatever big lot it was in Hollywood. And it was the office he'd had since he began. I walked in, it was all wood paneling. And there was first his manager, who was like 9,000 million years old, who I got to meet. And then I walked into this little room in the back that had lovely windows and a big, big desk. And there was George sitting in a director's chair next to the desk. And he was minuscule because he was like, I think, a couple years away from his 100th birthday or something. So he yeah. was just a bag of bones. But he was dressed to the nines. He had a drink, an alcoholic drink. He had a cigar. And he got up and I, you know, shook hands with him. And I had dressed like Gracie. I had on like this little 1940s outfit that was adorable, and I had my hair done, and I'd brought my guitar, and the whole thing was filmed, which is hilarious. But yeah, we sat and sang songs together, and he was very he was speaking firmly and with he definitely had his wits about him, but his voice was real soft because he was old.
Yeah.
And then at the end he was like, "So kid, you want to take some pictures?" And I was like, "Yeah." And so when I put my arm around him, I thought I was going to break him. He was really fragile. And I just, I'm there's one photo of me just looking at him in like serious glee and disbelief. And that picture hung in my grandparents' home for a long time. And to me, that was probably more important than even being on The Tonight Show, because Johnny did invite me both times over to the sofa to talk to him.
Right.
I don't know why. That was cool. But for my grandparents, getting to see someone from their era that
yeah.
I had loved and now I was hanging out with, they just thought that it was the coolest thing.
Right? Well, Ain't Misbehaving, right? I think is one of the songs
yeah.
you sang. And mm-hmm. he asked you, if I remember the story, because like I said, I've been friends with Sara a long time. He said, like, "Why aren't you doing this verse?" And you didn't know the other verse.
I've never heard that verse.
Because the recording.
On tape, I have him singing a verse no one else knows. I mean, maybe people from vaudeville.
Yeah.
But I was like blown away and he sang it for me. And I was playing guitar and I was like, I'm
yeah.
playing guitar and George Burns is singing.
So I don't want to make you cry, but I need to share this story with you.
Is everything okay?
Yeah. A couple weeks ago, a guy I work with came to me and he asked, "Do you have a few minutes?" I go, "Yeah." And he said, "You know, my grandfather had recently died." And I said, "Yes, I remember." He said, "And there's been some struggles and I need to take some more time off to kind of help." I said, "Okay." He said, "You know, my grandmother had died right before my grandfather. And he was just, I think he just couldn't keep living without her." And I said, "Not now, because it's too soon, but I want you to Google a song, 'Take Me With You' by Sara Hickman." I said, "And it's too soon now." I said, "But in a month or so," I said, "you will hear that song and you will have happy tears." I said, "When my grandmother died and my grandfather would, when we left him, he would just be at the front porch staring at us as we drove away, just sad that we were leaving. And it would break our hearts that we're leaving him alone. And Sara would always do 'Take Me With You' because it was about her grandparents. And I'm just missing her. And so, and I had not thought of that song, Sarah, in probably 15 years. But when he told that story, I immediately remembered Caravan of Dreams and you doing that because you knew Linda and I were in the audience. And Linda reaching over and grabbing my hand. And so thank you for that memory.
Clock is ticking somewhere down the hall. Candle playing shadows on the wall. Echoes of my life with you. I hear my heart calling. 60 years was not enough for me to show how much our love has grown to be. Now I see you dying to be.
You know, I think that's just what love does. You know, it tattoos on our heart. And if you're a songwriter, it's a tattoo you want to give to the world. So yeah, I love my grandparents, the musicians I was speaking of. It's those grandparents, and the fact that you love your grandparents. You know, I think. The beautiful thing about songs is they aren't ours.
No. You know?
We receive them, we put them together, we share them in the world, and they go on and they land in places we'll never know.
Yeah. You know?
Sometimes I'm there when I'm getting to perform for someone who's dying, or as we say, transitioning. There's no greater gift than to be with somebody in the last breaths of their life and to know that you're helping them leave the world feeling loved. So the fact that that song could, oops, hold on. I gotta let my dog in.
Okay.
Sorry.
No, you're good. Yay. I want to be on the podcast.
This is her second podcast today.
Yeah. She's loving it.
This is Twig.
Hi,
and
Twig.
Twig and my grandparents would have loved each other.
Yes.
Or you didn't get to meet Martha and Alan. So I was just telling Jesse about Take Me With You. Mm-hmm. It was. And Jesse's the sweetest. I hope you meet him someday. You guys would really like each other. So anyway, thank you for letting me babble on about.
No, that's true.
Our music is, it's really not ours. Nothing is ours.
No.
You know, these moments are ours. You and I are sharing right now. That's ours.
Yeah.
But this dog isn't mine. This cup isn't mine. I'm starting to sound like Steve Martin in The Jerk.
No, it's true.
I'm going to take this lamp.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, I will ask you the Mary question as we get closer to the end. But someone asked me once, if you were ever lucky enough to get Bruce Springsteen on your podcast, you would have to quit asking that question because he would give you the answer. And I think of the story, Isaac Asimov was doing a speaking engagement, the science fiction writer, and he was telling what a story meant, and someone raised his hand and said, Dr. Asimov, that's not right. That isn't what the story's about. And he goes, I wrote the story. I think I know what it's about. And the reader said, the audience member said, just because you wrote it, what makes you think you know what the story's about? And Asimov, as he's writing the story, and has said, I realized he was right. And so I now know that I know what I meant the story to be, but once I release it to the world, it takes a life and voice of its own. So, you know, you can only, you know what Song for My Father or, you know, Tiny Little Pill or, you know, or songs that you've written meant to you, but doesn't mean. My friend Bella years ago did an episode of Bruce Springsteen's Five Gayest Songs, you know, because she says, I'm a lesbian and Bruce Springsteen is a lesbian icon, whether he knows it or not.
Well, and he's a lesbian.
Yeah. So she's like, these songs are about his most gay songs. And she goes, whether he meant them to be or not, that's what they are, because that's what I listen to. I absolutely love that. I love the idea that you just send it out there and then the audience finds their own meaning.
Yeah. I mean, I think you, or at least I know for me, one of the greatest joys is when somebody says to me, you know, I heard this song and that lyric you have in there about blah, 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 made me think of, and it really helped me heal because I'd had this situation happen to me that was very painful. And I'll think, wow, that line is the line that brought something to somebody. And to me, yes, it meant this way over here.
Yes. But
they found this in that, and that's what they needed. So if my song gives you things that you need, wow, that's so spectacular, right? Because that helps the song live. I mean, if the song was just, I mean, look how long Baba Black Sheep or Mary Had a Little Lamb has been around, right?
Right.
And those are, you know, or if you think about it, what's the song? London Bridge is Falling Down, Ashes, Ashes. That's all about people having the Black Plague, right?
Yeah.
But that story's gone on to become a child classic. Now, now as today, maybe kids don't learn that song anymore because they're learning hip hop and stuff, which, yay. But yes, songs go on way past their creators, as do good stories.
So I was asked on a podcast a while back, what album have you bought the most of? And I think he was expecting me to say, well, I've bought Born to Run and cassette and CD and album. And I said, by far, Newborn by Sara Hickman. Because anytime anyone I'm even remotely involved friendship-wise, I find out they're expecting a baby, I go to your site, I order Newborn, and I send it to them. Because I truly think, and for those of you who don't know, Newborn was a CD that Sara did years ago. How many, is it 20, 25 years ago?
Well, yeah, it would have been right around after Lily was born. So 24 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there was Newborn. Oh, so there was Newborn, Toddler, then Big Kid.
Yeah.
And then Super Pal Universe was kind of a tween version.
Right.
Which was a band put together with tweeners. And then I had Newborn 2, T-O, that came out.
Yeah.
I don't know, 12 years ago, maybe? 18 years ago. So I really enjoy doing children's music because there's a lot less pressure on you to do a certain style.
Yeah.
So for me, children's music was a joy because I've always done a variety of styles as an adult musician. And that was always a problem for me in the record industry because they didn't know where to stick me.
Yes.
But when I started doing children's music, nobody cared. I could do whatever I wanted. And I had so much fun in the studio because I got to play.
Yeah.
And I mean play, like run around and find new instruments and try things and play all the instruments and sing all the lyrics. And, you know, it was just really, really fun to think about what children, how children see the world and to respond to that instead of writing as an adult to other adults or other.
Well, and, you know, and one of the things that you talked about as a new mom is that you wanted parents to sing to their children. It didn't matter if you have a good voice or could carry a tune, but the idea of connecting, you know, and whether it's goops in it.
We went to the doctor, you and me. I thought your eyes were booger-free. Then as the doctor opened the door, I spied a little something I hadn't spied before. Goops in it, doo-doo-doo, goops in it. Your little eyes got some goops in it. Oh, goops in it. Do 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 goops in it. Your little eyes got some goops in it.
That a lot of these children's songs, of course, came about after I had Lily and Io, Iolana, her second child, because things would happen and I would just respond with a song, for example, Goops in It. I was in the doctor's office with Lily, who was maybe 4 or 5, 6 weeks old, maybe. And my mom was with me and I noticed Lily had a little eye booger. So I started going, oh, you've got goops in it. And I would start going, goops in it, oh, goops. And then my mom started singing. And then I just made up this whole song. And then the doctor walked in, and this is when I knew I needed to switch pediatricians, because she had been an ex-Marine doctor or something. She did not find our singing humorous in the least. And she told me immediately that I should stop breastfeeding and use a formula. So I was like, sayonara, doctor.
Yeah, gotta go. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. But yeah, so the kids actually inspired me to write songs just by being themselves.
Yeah. If I remember correct, and we'll cut this out if I'm wrong, but my friend Sam is a huge Lucinda Williams fan. He just adores her, and I've been able to sing her, and she is an amazing musician and puts on a great show. But didn't you have a really nice story about her?
I have a lot of nice stories about her. She's I know the one you're talking about, and I will tell you about it, but I just want to give a shout out to Lucinda and to Nancy Griffith.
Yes, so sad.
They were two women that were very supportive and very kind to me. So the first time I met Lucinda, it was when I was on that tour with Kill Billy, actually. And we got to this club in Lawrence, Kansas. And on the sign outside, I think, and somewhere I have a photo of it, I think it says Lucinda Williams, Kill Billy, and then maybe Sara Hickman in really small letters. But the thing about that show that was awful and brilliant was that we got there to do sound check, and Lucinda wasn't there yet. And the manager or the owner of the club or whatever came into the club, and it was just the bartender, me, and Kill Billy, and the manager. And he comes up and he says, hey, we can't have three acts on one bill. That's ridiculous. So you are going to sing right now, and then when we open the doors, Kill Billy can start, and then Lucinda will play. And I was like, okay. And, you know, I didn't have anybody to say, no, that's wrong. I mean, the band wasn't going to do it, you know, and I don't blame them. And I couldn't do it because I'd rather sing than not sing at all. So I said, okay. Yeah. So I got up on the stage and I sang to a huge room, empty room, with somebody sweeping and the bartender. And I did my full set of 30 or 40 minutes. And then they opened the doors and people came in. And then Kill Billy played. And by the time Kill Billy finished, the place was packed. Like, you wouldn't want to be in there with COVID now. It was ridiculously packed. And so I'm backstage and Lucinda's on stage playing. And I think she was maybe 2/3 of the way through with her show. And all of a sudden I hear her say, you know, earlier, my good friend Sara Hickman was out here and they had her play to nobody. So I'm bringing her up right now to do a couple songs for everybody. And I was like, backstage, my mouth fell open. I was like, oh. So I go out there and I'd never met her. I didn't know her. But yeah. I go up and her band kind of kicked in and played behind me. And I sang a couple songs and I was like, thank you. And I left the stage. And then afterwards, she came up to me and we were backstage talking. And this sounds so silly, but I'd just gotten this beautiful bolo tie. They were kind of in then.
Yeah.
And I gave it to her and she loved it. And I just, from that moment on, I thought, this is the kind of person I want to be. You know, all these people that, you know, she was the first to impress upon me, always be kind to other musicians. Billy Bragg was the first to impress on me, speak your truth.
Yeah.
And speak loud. And, you know, John Denver was the first to get people to sing with you and to know about the world and the environment. And George Burns was the first to think it's okay to be funny and to be different. You know, so all these people, I don't want to start crying because, you know, I'm only 58, but it feels like they were all teachers and they didn't even know they were teachers, you know.
It's almost like they were angels, and we teach us when we hear, right? And we find us when it's time. Yes. By the way,
you and Linda are angels.
Yeah, I tell everyone, and I don't know if I've ever told you this in person, but you know, Barry Manilow did not write "I Write the Songs." Bruce mm-hmm. Johnston from the Beach Boys did, but many people would say the most Barry Manilow song is "I Write the Songs," and there are many that would say, and I agree, that "We Are Each Other's Angels" is one of the most Sara Hickman songs out there, and you didn't write it.
The only thing I wrote about it was, and I'm really grateful to Chuck Brodsky, who did write it, and I was introduced to the song to sing at someone's wedding.
Yeah.
A friend of mine, Kathy Turner. So she sends me this, you know, record back then.
Yeah.
And I heard this song and I went, oh, that's really cool. But I didn't like the last verse. So I called up this guy. I didn't even know Chuck Brodsky. And I said, hey, I really like this song and I'd like to record it, but can I rewrite the last verse? Because it just, his last verse was about being lost in the desert and manna falling from the sky.
Right.
To me, it felt like the song didn't have an arc, you know,
right.
It didn't have this big crescendo at the ending. And he was like, sure. So I was thinking, oh no, okay, I've said this, now what do I want to do? And the first thing I thought about was, well, we are each other's angels. We meet when it's time. And the beginning of the song talks about, I hope I see you later. It's time for me to go.
Yeah.
So I thought the end should be, now I'm in heaven. Now I'm,
right.
You know, 10,000 angels. And I thought of the number 10,000 because of 10,000 maniacs who are also on Elektra at the same time.
Yes.
I was on Elektra.
Right.
So 10,000 seemed like the number to use. And then the rest of it just kind of fell into place. And, you know, when I get to that part in the song, every time I just feel such a connection with people. I don't even feel like I wrote it. I feel like it was sent to me.
Yeah.
And I just got to be the receiver. And thankfully Chuck's let me record it every time with the end lyrics that are mine. And I'm really grateful. So.
Well, I reached my destination. Yeah, I finally made it home. God sent 10,000 angels to make me one of his own. Oh, but we are each other's angels. Oh, and we meet when it is time. Oh, we keep each other going, and we show each other signs, each other's angels. Oh, we are each other's angels. Oh, we are each other's angels. And we meet when it is done. Oh, we are each other's angels. We are each other's angels. Oh, we are each other's angels. Oh, we are each other's angels.
All right, we're going to end with another funny story. I hope this is funny. A few years ago, Sara was elected as the official state musician of Texas, which is a pretty big freaking deal. Now, she makes fun of it and she's like, eh, you know, and of course, what does Sara do? Sara takes this as a chance to goes and gets all these Texas musicians to do covers of her songs and to put it in a release that would fund art in school. Because that's what Sara is. Sara is always about giving to other people. But there's a story about Mr. Willie Nelson that I hope you will share. Because, you know, we've talked about my grandparents, we've talked about funerals. So I'm going to we're going to wrap it up because I've been talking to you over an hour and a half, and I feel very bad keeping you this long, but I figure you've got to, because the Willie story is hilarious.
Yeah, it is hilarious. And you know what? When you have Bruce on your podcast, which I really believe you will, I don't have a doubt about it. Ask him if Willie's covered one of his songs, which I'm sure Willie has. But you should always make sure who's ever on your podcast, if you're a musician,
see what song
of theirs Willie has covered. I just think that'd be cool.
That would be very cool.
So, So the album, I think it has 39 songs on it. It's a double disc. And I just thought, well, if I'm going to be state musician, what do I do? And the legislators were like, yeah, you don't do anything. It's, you know, just enjoy it. And I was like, well, that's silly. So I thought I would start this trend where the state musicians do something to give back, which we already do anyway, but, you know, why not? So I told them what I wanted to do, and they were like, well, we don't have any money to fund that. And I was like, no, don't worry about it. I'll figure it out. So I started asking musicians, and everybody was so great. I got Marsha Ball, I got Sean Colvin, I got Edie Brickell and New Bohemians, I got Brave Combo, I got Robert Earl Keen, I got Darden Smith, Ruthie Foster.
It is a who's who of Texas musicians.
The Flatlanders came together, and that was really fun. I went in the studio with them and played guitar, and they sang all three parts. It was amazing. But of course, I wanted Willie Nelson on there, and I knew Willie. But I didn't really know how to get in touch with Willie. So people would always say, just go to the bus. You know, he'll have you on the bus. And I said, if I go on the bus, I won't remember why I'm on the bus, because the minute he opens the door, I'm going to be high as a kite. So anyway, I was at this big to-do, this big party at the Four Seasons. And I was talking to my husband, Lance, and some other fun people. And I looked down the hall towards where we were all gathered, and here comes Willie. And he had his hair unbraided. I'd never seen it. And it was like past his, like to his knees. That's how long his hair was. I don't know how long it is now. And so he's walking down the hallway with his wife, and his hair is just like this beautiful crescendo of waving waves of beauty behind him. And he's coming closer, and so I realized, oh, this is a good chance. So he says hello to a bunch of people, and then he's coming closer. So I walk him and I say, hey, Willie. He says, hey, Sarah. And I said, hey, do you have a moment? Can I ask you this question? And he said, sure, what's up? So I told him he had just been state musician, and now I was state musician, and that I was doing this project, and it would be cool if he would sing on it. And he said, oh, yeah, I'd love to. And I said, well, how do I get a hold of you? And so he whispered his email in my ear, and I was like, thank you so much. And I gave him a hug, and I turned around, and I was just, you know, you can imagine I was on, it'd be like you meeting Bruce Springsteen and talking to him and him saying, yeah, I'm coming on your podcast. Right. So I turn around, and I'm in my enthusiasm. I grabbed my husband and laid a big kiss on his face, on his lips, but it wasn't my husband. It was Senator Kirk Watson, and who I know, thankfully, but he pulls away and he goes, Sarah, have you met my wife? And I look at his wife and I'm like mortified. But the first thing that comes out of my mouth, because I'm not thinking, I'm just really excited.
Yeah.
I say, oh, I'm so sorry. I'm just excited because I just got Willie, which sounded awful, you know, in a sexual way. And then I was like, I mean, Willie Nelson. I'm, you know, she's looking at me like, who are you? But yeah, that was pretty. And I've told that story in front of Kirk and his wife at events when I was the keynote speaker, because I'll see him there and I'll bring up and then everybody laughs and he just loves it. So I feel lucky that he thought it was funny too. But yeah, that's my Willie Nelson story. And then Willie did the recording, and there's more to it behind the scenes and all that.
Like,
but anyway,
he had to drive all night, right, to make a recording.
Yes, it was the day before. He was in Marathon, Texas on his tour bus with his band, and they got pulled over by a cop who went on the bus and realized there was pot on the bus, right? So Willie paid the fines for everybody on the bus. They got back on the bus. Hey, that's my dog. Sorry.
It's okay. Too.
Come here. Come back up. It's past her bedtime, so she's freaking out. So they got back on the bus and they drove all the way from Marathon, Texas to I guess it was Nashville, and where he was recording. And that was going to be the next morning. So I heard on the radio that Willie Nelson had been pulled over. And I thought, well, that's it. It's not going to happen because he's in Texas and he needs to be in Nashville. So I call up the next morning and I talk to Bud. That's the name of his engineer, Bud. I think that's hilarious.
That is greatness.
And I said, hey, Bud, this is Sara Hickman. And I was just calling to see if you talked to Willie, because I know he was supposed to record my song this morning and I'm really sad and I know he's not there. And Bud goes, why? What do you mean? He just came in and did it. And I was like, he's there? He's like, yeah, they drove all night to get here for you. And I was like, oh my gosh. So that's the kind of person Willie Nelson is. That's the kind of person we want to be in office.
Absolutely. Yes.
You know, it's just, what a great guy, right? He didn't have to do that.
No, that's great. All right. So for those of you who are Sara fans, that this is the first time you've heard of the podcast, I end every episode, though I'm now going to start asking, have you, any musician, I'm asked, has Willie Nelson ever covered your song? I asked the Mary question. So Jay Armstrong is an honors English teacher from the Philadelphia area. He just recently retired, and he would take his senior English, honors English class, and they would spend 2 days breaking apart the song Thunder Road. They would look at the lyrics, they would talk at the imagery, they would talk about the themes of the song, compare it to Robert Frost, The Road Not Taken. And then at the end of the song, the end of the 2 days, he asked the question, does Mary get in the car? So Sara Hickman, that's your question. Does Mary get in the car at the end of Thunder Road?
Oh, yes, I think so. I do. I think she gets in the car and their lives are gloriously changed forever. But then I'm an eternal optimist and I think that that's a beautiful way for the story to end.
I love that. Absolutely.
What do you think? I guess you're one.
Yeah, I absolutely, because I believe in happy endings. My audience is about 60% say yes, 40% say no. And it's always interesting to hear people's thoughts and reasons behind. Thank you, Sara Hickman, so much for doing this. I didn't get to ask you so many other questions.
That's okay. We'll have breakfast and I'll answer.
Yes, yes.
And then I can ask you a bunch of questions.
That's right.
I want to know more about you because you're so nice asking all the questions about me.
You didn't get to do Take Whatever I Can Get, which is one of my favorite songs you did. So I am gonna, yes. Tell me, I remember it one way, but I will get you, and then we're gonna get you out of here. But I'll Take Whatever I Can Get, I think, is a beautiful song, a story about how if you're a musician, you can take almost anything, make it to a song, and channel in positive ways versus destructive ways.
True. That is very true. Yes, yeah. That song came about because someone I was very in love with and I broke up, my doing. It was, you know, ridiculous. But anyway, you know, when you have a breakup, you go through this myriad of feelings, and I was feeling pretty sad, and I went to a bar. I've never done this before in my life, but I went to this bar in Los Angeles and I was by myself. It was the middle of the day. It was dark in the bar. I'm sitting at the bar. I'm having a drink and eating peanuts, but I was actually drinking water.
Because that's what you do, Sara. So, yeah.
I'm sitting in the bar in the middle of the afternoon, drinking water and eating peanuts. And the door to the bar opens and, you know, the sun was outside. So it looked like a silhouette of a man, right? And the man came in. And when he came in, I thought it was my ex-boyfriend. This guy looked so much like him. And he was walking towards me. And I thought, oh, my God, how did he find me? You know, what are the odds? And he came over and sat at the bar. And, of course, it wasn't my now ex-boyfriend. It was somebody that looked very similar to him. Up close, didn't really look like him at all. But he started, you know, conversing with me. And then I could tell he was flirting with me. And I was like, oh, my God, you know, what if... And then my songwriter brain took over, like, what if I went home with this person just because he looks like my ex-boyfriend? How pathetic would that be, right? Because you're just missing this person. It's so fresh. And so then this song, Take Whatever I Can Get, is about a woman. It's about being in a bar.
Yes.
And meeting somebody that looks like her ex-boyfriend and actually going home with him. And
it's, yes.
It's bittersweet, but it's also really funny.
It's a wonderful song. And it's you tell the whole story on Ready to Pop, which was your bootleg when you were pregnant, you know, that has now officially been released. It's just one of my favorite songs by yours, you know.
I should go home. I know this is wrong, but I'm glued to my chair. Can't do nothing but stare at the sky. I'm feeling sick, sort of confused. Here comes a ghost I can never lose. He's sitting down right next to me, pretending he's you. There's nothing I can do. He's got your eyes, he's got your face, he's got your moves, and he's working the entire place. Have I lost my mind? I cannot forget he isn't you, but I'll take whatever I can get. Now, now, now.
I'm gonna let you go, Sara, but
thank you, Jesse. You're so kind to spend so much time with me.
No. I do have to just take a few minutes, and for those of you who don't want to be reminded of what's going on, skip ahead. It's some dark days in Texas, Sara. And it is, there are the latest political changes and the laws that they have put in place just really break my heart. And I see, you know, people on social media saying such bad things about Texas. And I try to argue there are a lot of us that are trying very hard to change things. And so one of the things you have been very active is supporting Beto. You have always pushed very hard for women's right to choose and equality and for fair voting. And so
Black Lives Matter.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, you just, and so thank you for that. There are songs that you have written from the perspective of the mother of someone who went and killed, murdered people. And you've written from the mother because she still loves her son. You've written songs of people who, and Linda gives you credit all the time. There is a song you wrote about someone drowning, and that song gave her strength that, well, I'm not going to drown, but if I did, Sara made it sound like it's a pleasant experience. I'm going to be okay, you know? And so you have always been an advocate. And so do you have any words of hope for us, Sara?
Well, you know, I think the interesting thing about humanity is wherever we are and whatever we're in, it feels like the worst or the best.
Yeah.
Right now it feels like the worst, but if you reflect on history, in the long run, and sadly after many people are harmed or murdered or, you know, bad things happen, like for example, this pandemic, and we've seen the best of humanity and the worst of humanity in the last year and a half, I really believe things come back around because common sense and love and light prevail. It may not happen when we want it to, like Leonard Cohen says, when things have a crack in them, that's how the light gets in. And Texas has taken many leaps forward recently. So has our country. You know, the last president was a very, if not to me, the darkest, one of the darkest times in American history, aside from the Civil War. And what's happened to Native people in the United States, how we've treated Native Americans and the Japanese internment camps. I mean, you've done a lot of bad things, slavery being the worst. So when you look at that context, there are things far worse than what's happening right this second.
Yeah.
But because we're living in it and our children are having to deal with it, especially specifically, if I may say, our daughters, it is very akin to Handmaid's Tale. And that's terrifying because I as a human being would like to be treated with respect and dignity. And I would like to be able to make choices about myself that are private.
Yeah.
You know, right now, the way it is in Texas, if I drove somebody to Planned Parenthood, they couldn't get an abortion anymore. But let's say they could, I could be turned in for driving that person. So I would like to say openly, and you can edit this out or you can leave it in, but when I was 19, I had an abortion. Was it giddy? Was I happy about it? No, I took a lot of time to think about it. And I had some very wise counsel from other women. And I decided for myself, it was something that I needed to do. I have my own personal feelings about abortion. I promised myself after that one, I would never do it again, no matter what. And I never did.
Yeah.
That's me.
Right.
I certainly understand if someone says, I would never get an abortion. I support that.
I do too.
I think he should.
Yeah.
I also support if either of my children got pregnant or were raped or there was incest involved with a friend of mine and having to go through that 9 months was too much for them. That's their personal decision. Much like God is your personal decision, much like where you choose to work is your personal decision, what car you drive is your personal decision. So I'm not going to quit fighting, and I'm just really angry that all the men and women, particularly the women who've fought so hard for decades and decades and decades and decades and centuries to be given the right to their own body, have now just had that all taken away in the state of Texas and other states that are moving forward with that same idiotic. I mean, I can't believe it's almost 2022, and this is still the,
yeah.
You know, it was settled in 1973. Just find other things to.
Well, and, you know, my frustration is, but we don't want to fund birth control. We don't want to fund sex education.
Yes.
If you truly are against unwanted pregnancies, there are so many ways you could, but no, that isn't what about.
And personally, I think men should be fined. Why
yeah,
are we
exactly.
women the one? Men put their unit inside
yeah.
a woman.
Yes.
They're the ones that cause us to get pregnant. We can't get pregnant by ourselves.
I read somewhere that if men were the ones that pregnant, that unwanted pregnancies would be like an ATM. You would just could go get it and it'd be done.
Mm-hmm. Well, and all these people that are not for abortion, which, you know, again,
I get it.
I understand.
Absolutely.
And there's a lot I can agree to on that. I can understand it. I can also say, though, more strongly, that it is none of your effing business.
Yeah.
It's nobody's business. And all these high-powered Republican men and
yeah.
conservative men, if they want to be called that, who get their mistresses pregnant, they're going to still get them abortion.
Absolutely.
And that's an assumption, and that's a broad brush I'm painting.
Yes.
But when I was living in Dallas, the woman down the street from me,
yeah,
and she was married, which is here nor there. I
yeah.
didn't care if she wasn't married. But she, her child, she was like 5 months into her pregnancy.
Yeah.
And the baby died inside her.
Mm-hmm.
And she went to the hospital. She knew something was wrong. And they said, yes, your baby has died.
Yeah.
But she couldn't find a doctor. This was in the 90s. And I don't remember why. But I know that President Bush, there was a big anti-choice movement going on. She had to carry that baby full term. Dead.
How sad.
Now, why would you do that to someone? They're already in mourning to find out that the child they love has just died. So late term abortion isn't about women going, I don't want to have this baby. I'm just going to take it, get it ripped out. It is a horrific, sad, traumatizing moment in a woman's life and a husband's life or a partner's life or a gay woman's life. It
Absolutely.
Doesn't matter. It's they make it sound like it's just a trip to the ice cream store, and it is not. I mean, I still wonder, you know, what would my child have been like? She would be 43 now or something, right?
Yeah.
That's crazy. And I don't know if it was a she or he, but I gave it a name and I think about it and I miss this baby I didn't have. It wasn't an easy decision. So
no,
I just feel like it's a distraction thing. They keep distracting us with the death penalty and abortion and immigrants, aka refugees in my mind, because they don't want us to think about equal rights. They don't want us to think about how Black Lives Matter. They don't want to think about how I should get paid the same amount a man gets paid. And for that, Black women and Hispanic women should get paid as much as all of us get paid too. And they get paid even less than I do because I'm a white woman.
And I'm amazed, Sarah, that I'm a 62-year-old white guy. And I'm like, how can some of my people I know not recognize that my experience is totally different than someone was born in a different circumstances with a different skin color and a different economic situation. So absolutely.
Well, and lastly, I want to throw this in there.
Please.
The reason we have global warming, the reason we have plastics in the oceans and why, there's fish off of Namibia. I can never say that country right. The fishing industry there has died because there's too many jellyfish choking up the water. And so the fish have all died. So they've lost their income. And people are literally starving because they can't get the fish out of the ocean because they aren't there anymore because of us, because of people.
Right.
So the fact that people are not pro-choice because we need it to, first of all, the population explosion on the planet is crazy.
Yeah.
We're done. We're done for if we don't stop having more people on the planet. I'm not saying abortion is the end all be all, but people need to start being respectful of each other's bodies and having children, because what are we leaving behind? Another 50, 75 years on this planet for the people that are here now? We won't be here maybe, but I don't want my kids to live in that kind of a world.
I don't either. And I know you are fighting with every inch of your being to make a difference. I know I am too. I will end this political segment with saying that, and I will put a warning before. I'm like, okay, Sarah and I get deep, so skip ahead to the end if you don't want to hear this, but I do hope people listen. And you know, and I get frustrated, Sarah, because you know, I do email and I call my local congressman, my state representative, my state senator, our two senators, and it's like they don't care, because I am more liberal and I am a minority and they just don't give an F what I think. But that they aren't going to shut me up. I'm going to continue to call their offices. I'm going to continue to email their offices. I'm going to continue to post on social media, and I'm going to say I matter, and what my opinion matters, and you need to listen to me. And I think we all need to continue that fight. And I know that's one of the things that you have during your quote unquote retirement. You have spent a lot of energy to try to support the social causes you believe in. And for that, I appreciate you, my friend.
Thank you. I just want to end by saying, there are already millions of beautiful children here. So stop fussing over choice and start fussing over the children that are here and loving them. It matters. You know, every child deserves a home and clean water and good food and love. And we would have a lot less problems on this planet if people would live in the present and take care of those around them. We would have less homeless. We would have less children in orphanages.
Yeah, I Well said, my friend.
I appreciate you talking to me and asking serious questions and funny questions.
Yes. Listeners, thank you for letting me talk to one of my dearest friends. This is truly a wonderful moment for me, and I will join you on your podcast anytime you want, Sarah.
Yes,
go get vaccinated, people. Remember to wear your mask, wash your hands, remember to social distance, speak your voice. Do not let them quiet you. You matter, we matter, and let's all be good to each other, because that's the only way we're going to get through this. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, listeners. We'll talk to you soon. Goodbye.
Bye, Jesse. I wish I were a princess. I wish
Thank you to my Patreons, Andrew Goddard, Betsy Hodges, Levi Petri, Elizabeth Bronson, Stephen Malio, Holly Mack, Steve Rogers, Dale Hosick, Terry Smith, Anna Lynn, Chris Bloom, and Mary Thomas. You all are my monthly angels. Thank you so much for the love and support you give on this podcast. You are greatly appreciated.
You just heard the fun-talking, hard-rocking, music-loving, album-ranking, fan-thinking, joy-spreading, lyric-reading, story-sharing podcast that is the one, the only, Set Listing Bruce. The theme for Set Listing Bruce was written by David Rosen, used by permission.
You know, we didn't get to talk about more stories about you on the road. I would love to talk about other albums. So we will have you on again. But for now, thank you so much, Sara. And
I'm going to put one last goal in the universe before we hang up, which is if I ever have the opportunity or if I can make the opportunity happen where I sing a duet with Bruce, you will be there.
All right. That sounds good. That sounds great. I will splice this in. So for those of you who are listening to the unedited version, you know, I have a small little Patreon group. And so I always put the unedited episodes up. So you will hear that Sara, like after I hit record, like, oh, by the way, can you do? Oh, let me go back. So I just love you. And
I love you too. I love you so much. And I love Linda. I love Chris. And I'm so grateful. I don't think you know how grateful I am. And also, just remind people that you were the president of my fan club for a while. And
I was.
Really cool to tell people Jesse Jackson. And people go, the Jesse Jackson? I was like, yes, the Jesse Jackson.
And you talk about me when it is time, the odds of us going to see Molly, you opening, and you happening to come up and see me. Just you happen to like, you know, and then.
There are no coincidences.
Look at this journey. You know? I will send you a link. Bruce Springsteen wrote a song for his mother called The Wish. And there is a line, and it'll break your heart, Sara, because there's a line in you'll know me in a glance. And she is now Alzheimer really bad. And so on Broadway, he says, you'll know me in a glance. You'll know me in a glance. But anyway, there is a line where they're sitting around the kitchen and they're talking about all the things the guitar brought them. Because the song starts with a dirty old streetlight and underneath a shining star is a brand new Japanese guitar about him getting a guitar for Christmas. And in the end of the song, he talks about, we're sitting around talking about all the things that guitar has brought us. And I know you feel that way, but I think about all the things our friendship has brought us. There was times when you were struggling with your oldest child and went, Jesse, does it get any better? I'm like, yes, it does. It's going to be okay. But I remember one show where your voice was falling is right after you'd had, and you walked off stage, you had hardly been able to sing, and you stumbled into Linda and I's arms, and you were almost crying and hugging. But it was so good catching up with you, and love to all your family. And I will let Linda and Chris know, and they cannot wait to hear the podcast, I'm sure.
Oh, I love you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
Love you too. See you soon. Okay. Bye-bye.
Life's become a great big list of things to do and buy and fix. At night we pass out before 10. Are we ever gonna have sex again? I looked for your it today, seeing as it had gone away. Well, it ain't been used since who knows when. Are we ever gonna have sex again?